Family, a prayer that we pray together is a powerful prayer. So please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we pray for the deceased. Heavenly Father, the lasting hope of all who believe, we trust in your goodness. We pray for our loved ones who have died. We pray too for all those who helped us during their lives, our friends, our teachers, clergy, religious, and all of our benefactors who have died. Grant them eternal rest, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed through your mercy rest in peace. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints,
and you, my
brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Christ.
Siena on fire with divine love in her contemplation of the Lord's passion and her service of your church. Grant through her intercession that your people, participating in the mystery of Christ, may ever exult in the revelation of his glory, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. As the number of disciples continued to grow, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. So the 12 called together the community of the disciples and said, "It is not right for us to neglect the word of God to serve at table. Brothers, select from among you 7 reputable men, filled with the Spirit and wisdom, whom we shall appoint to this task, whereas we shall devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the Word." The proposal was acceptable to the whole community. So they chose Stephen, a man filled with faith and the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas of Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid hands on them. The word of God continued to spread, and the number of the disciples in Jerusalem increased greatly. Even a large group of priests were becoming obedient to the faith. Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
Lord, let your mercy be on us as we place our trust in you.
Exalt you just in the Lord. Praise from the upright is fitting. Give thanks to the Lord on the harp. The 10-string lyre chants his praises.
Lord,
upright is the word of the Lord, and all his works are trustworthy. He loves justice and right. Of the kindness of the Lord, the earth is full.
Lord, let your mercy be on us, as we bless our trust.
See, the eyes of the Lord are upon those who fear him, upon those who hope for his kindness, to deliver them from death and preserve them in spite of famine.
Lord, let your mercy.
Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem.
Gloria tibi.
disciples of Jesus went down to the sea, embarked in a boat, and went across the sea to Capernaum. It had already grown dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea was stirred up because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they began to be afraid. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." They wanted to take him into the boat, but the boat immediately arrived at the shore to which they were headed. Verbum Domini. Every one of us has spiritual and material needs. But our greatest need above every other need is for God, for His love, for His truth, for His mercy. However, there are times when our material needs will sometimes get in the way of our spiritual needs, our greatest needs. Our need for God. And then when this occurs, here comes worry, here comes anxiousness, all sorts of things, doubt, fear, just invades us. We need to remember, as these readings communicate to us today, that God knows all of our needs. And that He's always coming to us. That He's always there for us. Now Jesus says in the Gospel of Luke, He says, seek first the kingdom of, the Lord, the Father knows all your needs. And He says, and then He says, He will provide. He says, but seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be given unto you. Here in the gospel again, we have the disciples here, and they're on the boat. They've already went out 3 or 4 miles, and they're now encountering some rough waters. So the waves are high, the sea is strong, and they're a bit worried, but then they see Jesus walking on the water, coming to them. And at this passage here, Jesus is not only going to console them and comfort them, but He's also right now trying to build their faith. The Lord is preparing to speak to us. This is John chapter 6, but He's going to tell us about eventually the greatest teaching of this chapter is about the Holy Eucharist. Going to teach us about His body and blood, that this is necessary for our salvation. Earlier in the chapter, we see Him multiplying loaves and fishes. It's that He will be everywhere with us. He will come to us. He will provide. Now that this was a great sign here, the multiplication of loaves and fishes, and here is another one. So we have a sign like bread, and we have another supernatural sign where, you know, both times people have needs. And there Jesus is providing. He's meeting the temporal needs we see first. But now He's ultimately preparing us for our greatest need, which is for Himself, for God. We all need the Lord. And we all need to be aware of His presence with us. Jesus is most present with us in the body and blood, soul and divinity of the Holy Eucharist, which we receive here. This should be our greatest of all desires, everything we need. It's his body and blood. It's him coming into us. But again, you know, there's things that distract us, things that will worry us. But Jesus, this should be the one thing that who is our greatest craving. It's a need for God. God will provide for everything else. Here's another example of God providing. In the first chapter here, the first reading here in Acts chapter 6. The disciples are receiving some complaints that some of the needs of some of the widows, the people in the Hellenistic community are not being met. Well, they bring this concern to the disciples, and then they answer this need by ordaining seven servants, what we would call now deacons. And they are to serve, of course, to assist at table. They are to also provide for the needs of the community, the temporal needs, the spiritual needs. We know Philip and who are listed here, Philip and Stephen, we see them evangelizing, you know, and this is where we begin the service of deacons, where this is ultimately starting. Of course, it develops through the years, but the deacons who are servants, here this is established for the needs of the people. And ultimately, this is God who's orchestrating all of this here for the needs of the people. So again, here we see that God always provides. We don't have to worry. Now we go back here, and we see here, of course, again, a supernatural sign, a wonder. Jesus walking on the water. And again, soon we're going to see him talking about the bread of life. And we know what happens afterwards is that he, you know, when he gives this bread of life discourse, many people don't believe. He just performed these signs and wonders in front of them. And they don't accept this teaching. Well, you know, this sometimes often happens to us. We've experienced perhaps many signs and wonders of the Lord. He's comforted us, he's consoled us on many occasions, several of them. He's provided for us, but then here come the current circumstances, and it's these are heavy, these are troublesome, burdensome. And sometimes we get a little swallowed up in that. We can doubt again. We can become very afraid. But we forget our greatest need for God. And how do we solve that? How do we come out of this? Well, we go to the one who we need most, the Lord. And remember that he also himself, being fully God and fully man, had needs. And we see Jesus living in poverty, going from place to place, relying on the goodness of the people. But everything's always provided for him. We see him poor. You know, remember the gospel reading, he says, you know, foxes have dens, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. So this is what we need to do. When we have our own needs, instead of letting those consume us and trouble us to the point where we doubt or we become very afraid or we start to lose hope, think about Jesus and his needs. Think about Jesus and his sufferings. And we'd be amazed that provides so much consolation to us. Jesus, who was hungry too, Jesus, who was thirsty, Jesus, who suffered, you know, and much more agony than any of us will ever suffer. Think about that. So go to the poverty of Jesus, go to the needs of Jesus, go to the suffering of Jesus, and this will provide us with the comfort we need, the hope we need. because when we go to him, we know that he will provide, because he has compassion, he has empathy and mercy. And the church communicates this to us all the time. In these current times, you know, we've seen the Holy Fathers, especially now Pope Francis. There's some kind of crisis in the world of people who experience some type of catastrophe or crisis. He always says something about it right away, tries to comfort them, tries to console them, looks to their needs. Today we celebrate St. Catherine of Siena. You know, she was a woman who loved God very much, a Dominican in the Third Order, lived in the 14th century. And herself, you know, she had her own needs and she suffered, but yet she wasn't so focused on these needs, on her own sufferings. She was focused on the Lord, her greatest need, giving herself to him in prayer and in service. And she lived during the time of the plague. And, you know, the plague was killing people by the thousands. And yet she wasn't afraid. She went out, she helped nurse people, helped people give them food, you know, cooked and cleaned and all that, all those things. But since her first love, her great, and she knew that her greatest need was God, that, you know, immediately she started to act like God, like Jesus. Wasn't so concerned about herself, but then started to give. So we see the fruits of knowing who our greatest need is and responding quickly, going to him soon. Remember, he's always come to us, he's always there, and he will provide. And then what happens is that we're aware of God, we love him, we know he's our greatest need, he's everything we hunger for, he's everything we thirst for, and when we're focused on that, and when we're trying to be consoled and thinking about his poverty and his needs and his suffering, then we have much more strength. Then, you know, it's so much easier to think and to react like him, because we put ourselves in his presence. We place ourselves in his mind. And we know St. Paul says we have the mind of Christ. This is part of the graces we receive. This is part of the graces that are nourished again in the Holy Eucharist. And so, my brothers and sisters, we go to Jesus, the Lord, in all occasions, because he is our all and he is our everything. And once again, he will provide. All that is needed is that we seek first the kingdom of God. We seek Jesus first, and all these things will be given to us. Our Father loves us. He knows what we need, even before we ask. God bless you all.
Offer our petitions to the Father and give him thanks for saving us from sin and death.
That the Church may rejoice in the boundless mercy of God, which has achieved our salvation, and celebrate the glory that has been bestowed upon us in Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the lay faithful may have the courage and generosity to take on increasing responsibility for the Church's works of education and evangelization. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may not be afraid to be faithful to Jesus' teaching on the dignity of human life, even if our faithfulness causes some to separate from us. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase in vocations to the priesthood and the consecrated life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may rest in peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father, through the mystery of the resurrection, grant us the peace promised by your Son to those who trust in him. We make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. My sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all of this holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the saving sacrifice we offer in commemoration of Saint Catherine, so that, instructed by her teaching, we may give ever more fervent thanks to you, the one true God, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in the saints who consecrated themselves to Christ for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, it is right to celebrate the wonders of your providence by which you call human nature back to its original holiness and bring it to experience on this earth the gifts you promise in the new world to come. And so, with all the angels and saints, we praise you as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus.
therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, and all those who hold him to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all those and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or the offering for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true, in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas,